This video will cover how to represent bridge piers in an SRH-2D model using the SMS interface. Bridge piers come in many different shapes, sizes, and configurations, which has implications for conveyance, backwater, and local flow patterns through the bridge. Common pier types include reinforced concrete pier walls, as well as open pier arrangements that allow for flow to pass between piles and columns. Concrete columns and timber pile piers are common examples of this. When the pier is aligned with flow, the shape of the pier nose can have impacts on local flow patterns at the pier. Common pier nose shapes include square, round, and sharp nose piers. Along the vertical axis, piers can range in complexity from a simple uniform column to a more complex pier with components that vary in width, shape, and configuration. Common components of a complex pier include the pier cap, the pier column, the pile cap or footing, and pile groups. When representing a pier, the modeler will need to know the location, orientation, geometry, and pier component elevations. There are three methods that can be used to represent bridge piers for an SRH model. The first method is to create a hole in the mesh to represent the length, width, and shape of the pier. Figure A29 in FHWA's 2D reference document shows several ways that a pier may be modeled as holes in the mesh. The hole should be similar in size and shape to the outline of the pier. Typically, the pier width would be used for the element size.
No more than three elements needs to be used across the pier width.
It is reasonable to simplify pier shape using square elements to represent circular, round-nosed, or sharp-nosed piers within the mesh.
When the SRH-2D self-centered solution is interpolated to the mesh nodes, a zero velocity at the element edges along the pier is assumed.
Using a hole to represent a pier will force water to flow around the pier and will also allow for resulting head loss caused by the pier. The second method is similar, except instead of making a hole in the mesh, an unassigned material type is used to represent the pier. This informs the model not to include any unassigned elements in calculations. The model will only remove an element from calculations if the centroid of the element overlaps with the unassigned material type. The unassigned element should be similar in size, shape, and location as the pier. The third method is to use an obstruction to represent the piers. Obstructions are useful when the pier size is small compared to the typical elements, but they will not represent detailed hydraulics at the pier location. When representing piers with obstructions, SRH adds a drag force to represent the head loss associated with the pier. Within the obstruction parameters window, the modeler can define the pier width or diameter, the bottom elevation, and a drag coefficient. The bottom elevation should be set below ground elevation for the bridge piers. Instabilities may form in the model when the element size is significantly less than the flow depth, particularly when the bridge experiences pressure flow conditions.
The model stability is only sensitive to the length of the elements, not the width. It is recommended that the length be roughly equal to or greater than the local flow depth where possible. This does not apply to localized areas of higher mesh resolution around piers or other features.
This can lead to challenges when the pier widths are significantly smaller than the flow depth. One solution is to gradually increase the element size further away from the pier whenever possible. If detailed hydraulic conditions are not needed at the bridge, also consider using large elements with piers as obstructions. The stability of the solution should be monitored in places where the element size is significantly smaller than the flow depth. There are several different approaches to modeling a complex pier. For piers with large exposed footings or pile caps, the footing may be represented within the mesh terrain. This reduces the number of modeling assumptions that need to be made for the pier. Alternatively, representative area can be used when two or more components of the pier are exposed to flow. For this method, the user scales the width of the pier to the relative flow depth of each component. If the channel has the potential for large debris, additional width may be added to the pier to account for the hydraulic effects of debris accumulation. Discussion about debris accumulation on piers can be found in section 7.7 of FHWA's HEC 18 manual and in section 4.6 of HEC 9. If piers are likely to accumulate debris in between tightly spaced columns, the pier may be best represented as a single wall rather than as individual columns. When columns are spaced less than 5 times the column width apart and debris accumulation between columns is not significant, the individual columns should be treated as a single wall pier with a length equivalent to the total column width. This is described in further detail in section 7.6 of HEC 18. These different methods of modeling piers can lead to different hydraulic conditions and flow patterns below a bridge. The modeler should consider the level of analysis that is required, as well as modeling constraints when choosing which method to use. For example, representing piers as holes in the mesh is recommended when detailed velocity and flow distribution through the bridge is desired, and when pier width and length is not significantly different than the mesh elements in the bridge area. Using obstructions for piers can adequately represent upstream backwater effects and account for head loss due to the piers, but does not provide detailed flow characteristics through the bridge. For this reason, they are only recommended for use at secondary bridge locations that are not the main focus of the model. Piers can be visualized in SMS using 3D shapes. This representation is only graphical and does not impact hydraulic model results. Visualizing piers as 3D shapes is described in more detail in the 3D bridge video by FHWA.